speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory.
In this week's reflection, I'd like to invite you to join me in morning prayer in the form of the Church of England's daily office. As people who follow Christ, or people who are on a journey to find God in Jesus, making time to be with God helps us to discover God, to discover God for ourselves. This is what some Christians have shared about their daily patterns of personal time with God.
Yes, I've got a few patterns that help me follow Christ. I'd say the main one being regular worship. Having a structured prayer pattern, I think, is incredibly important, especially as we still, and we always are, learning about our faith and exploring our faith.
And often singing some sort of worship song or listening to some sort of piece of music is part of my daily routine as well.
I'm really bad, I think, at being disciplined in my daily prayer. I think a lot of other Christians I know are much better at that, and indeed people of other faiths as well.
I begin each day with a period of meditation, mostly in silence, and that's a space to let go and to give space for God to talk to me. And I end each day by saying the daily office, by saying Compline, and so I can bring to God all the things which have happened in that day.
Late last thing at night, I use this app on my phone. It's an Examine app, which is a version of the Ignatian Examine, which helps you look back at the day and see where God was in it, and the things that went well, and things that went really badly, and I find that really helpful.
My wife and I, we pray every morning. We pray, if we can, before a small icon in our bedroom, and we sing a song, usually one of the chants from Tezzy.
When I'm driving, listen to worship songs, and I tend to do lots of praying when I can. It's not structured, and it's not the same prayer. It's more me just talking to God as a conversation.
O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. A song of God's glorious name from Psalm 8. O Lord, our Governor, how glorious is your name in all the world. Your majesty above the heavens is praised. Out of the mouths of babes at the breast, you have founded a stronghold against your foes, that you might still the enemy and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have ordained, what are mortals that you should be mindful of them? Mere human beings that you should seek them out? You have made them little lower than the angels, and crown them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands, and put all things under their feet.
all sheep and oxen, even the wild beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatsoever moves in the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Governor, how glorious is your name in all the world. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen.
I think the part of the Bible I value the most is definitely the Gospels. The first reason being Christ, his earthly ministry, that he sets out, his teachings, and all the things we can take away from that.
I most value the book of John, actually. It's the most beautiful and poetic outpouring of emotion, a connection of one man with the Lord, but a kind of inspiration for everybody. It's poetry and faith and beauty and justice all rolled into one.
The part of the Bible which I most value are the Gospels, and then New Testament. They are for me my instruction manual, or something that I use very often.
I've quite recently come to like the Book of Psalms, because I went through a long phase where I couldn't believe in God at all, and where I couldn't pray, and to read the prayers of people who have prayed this many thousand years ago kind of makes me feel connected.
I would have to say the Gospel. Everything should come back to that, because it tells us about the incarnation of the Word.
I like the Book of Job. I'm sure many people say that, though, because he has a lot of struggles. I think we all go through that, so it's easy to associate that.
I love the world as it is whole, really, because, again, during a different period of life, I go to different parts. Old Testament, New Testament stories are excellent.
When I was young, I would be about 16, I read Revelations, and it still terrifies me to this day. So that's quite resonant with me as well.
There's a line from Philippians, live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, and that's very close to my heart.
Probably the calmer of the waters, because at the time my waters were a little bit ropey and rocky, and you know, and the feeding of the 5,000, just the general things he did, which sort of gets you even thinking, well, how did he do this? You know, what did he do it for? What's Jesus about? And that's why I went back to church and found out more about why he died for us. Because back then I didn't realise that's what he actually did.
Psalm 119, reading from verse 105 to 117. Your word is a lantern to my feet, and a light upon my path. I have sworn and will fulfill it, to keep your righteous judgments. I am troubled above measure. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept the freewill offering of my mouth, O Lord, and teach me your judgments. My soul is ever in my hand. yet I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I have not strayed from your commandments. Your testimonies have I claimed as my heritage forever, for they are the very joy of my heart. I have applied my heart to fulfill your statutes, always, even to the end. I hate those who are double-minded, but your law do I love. You are my hiding place and my shield, and my hope is in your word. Away from me, you wicked. I will keep the commandments of my God. Sustain me according to your promise, that I may live. And let me not be disappointed in my hope. Hold me up, and I shall be saved, and my delight shall be ever in your statutes. O God, save us from ourselves, from double standards and divided hearts, and give us light and life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Thank you.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 27, as recorded by the Apostle Luke. When it was decided that we were to set sail for Italy, they transferred Paul and some other prisoners to a centurion of the Augustan cohort named Julius, embarking on a ship of Adramyttium that was about to set sail to the ports along the coast of Asia. We put to sea, accompanied by Aristarchus, a Macedonian from Thessalonica. The next day we put in at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly and allowed him to go to his friends to be cared for. Putting out to sea from there, we sailed under the lee of Cyprus, because the winds were against us. After we had sailed across the sea, that is off Cilicia and Pamphylia, we came to Myra in Lycia. There the centurion found an Alexandrian ship bound for Italy and put us on board. We sailed slowly for a number of days and arrived with difficulty off Cnidus. And as the wind was against us, we sailed under the lee of Crete, of Salmone. Sailing past it with difficulty, we came to a place called Fair Havens, near the city of Lyre, of Lassi. Since much time had been lost and sailing was now dangerous, because even the fast had already gone by, Paul advised them, saying, "Sirs, I can see that the voyage will be with danger and much heavy loss, not only of the cargo and the ship, but also our lives." But the centurion paid more attention to the pilot and to the owner of the ship than to what Paul said. Since the harbour was not suitable for spending the winter, the majority was in favour of putting to sea from there, on the chance that somehow they could reach Phoenix, where they could spend the winter. It was a harbour of Crete, facing southwest and northwest. When a moderate south wind began to blow, they thought they could achieve their purpose. So they weighed anchor and began to sail past Crete, close to the shore. But soon a violent wind called a northeaster rushed down from Crete. Since the ship was caught and could not be turned with its head to the wind, we gave way to it and were driven. By running under the lee of a small island called Cordia, we were scarcely able to get the ship's boat under control. After hoisting it up, they took measures to undergird the ship. Then, fearing that they would run on the Syrtis, they lowered the sea anchor and so were driven. They were being pounded by the storm so violently that on the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. And on the third day, with their own hands, they threw the ship's tackle overboard. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and no small tempest raged, all hope of our being saved was at last abandoned. Since they were being without food for a long time, Paul then stood up among them and said, "Men, you should have listened to me and not have set sail from Crete, and thereby avoided this damage and loss. I urge you now to keep up your courage, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For last night there stood by me an angel of God to whom I belong and whom I worship. And he said, 'Do not be afraid. Paul, you must stand before the emperor.' And indeed, God has granted safety to all those who are sailing with you. So keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will be exactly as I have been told. But we will have to run aground on some island.
The Benedictus, the Song of Zechariah from Luke chapter 1. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets God promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath God swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life. And you, child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of all their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Celebrating when things go well, I thank God. I pray before meals when I'm with other people, we say grace.
Possibly last thing at night, hopefully, because that's when I say thank you for all things that happened to me during that day. And I ask for his blessing for the day to come.
I usually wake up early in the morning around 4 o'clock, and I believe that is when God literally wakes me up and say, come time, it's time to talk about many things before the day began.
For me, it's important to be in church to pray. That's where I find I pray best, and in an old-fashioned way quite often when I light a candle, and certainly when I take communion.
Even exercising, swimming and running is a great way to pray and encounter God.
It's not that when and where I pray. I can pray in bus, I can pray in taxi, I pray on bed, I pray in chapel, I pray in church. So and there's no specific time.
If I'm sat at my desk, if I'm at home, at the sink, washing dishes, if I'm in the car, everywhere, you know, God is everywhere.
There doesn't have to be a specific time or place or reason. It can be out loud, it can be to yourself. See someone walking past, you think, oh, I can pray for them.
Prayer for me is not always asking, it's more about giving, acknowledging and giving thanks, noticing, you know, nature and giving thanks.
God, my Heavenly Father, I come to you as your Son, my Saviour, Jesus, came to you. Thank you for bringing me to this day. Thank you for bringing my Brian, my family, friends, parishioners, and all who have come safely to this day. Be with me and each of them, and help us to lift our eyes and the eyes of our hearts and minds to the wonder and gladness of this day. Help us to pause at each good thing, that we may be truly thankful and that we may enjoy your blessings. Help us to be aware of the needs and concerns of others, of our community, and of the world. Cause us to pause, to pray especially for those for whom this day has brought trials and difficulties, whether expected or unexpected. Today I bring before you those who are fearful, my parishioners who are isolating and feel lonely in isolation, those who are struggling or filled with despair about their future due to life-limiting disease, pain, and illness, and those traumatized by decimated livelihoods and dismantled plans. Lord, in your mercy, hear my prayer. Be with each person who is missing loved ones. And today I remember Auntie Linny as she recalls her final days with Uncle Jim before his passing last year. And parishioner Joyce, whose Jim passed suddenly on All Saints' Day last year. Father God, you know who is grieving. Comfort them, comfort us, and surround us with your love and peace, and draw us into the hope of life eternal. Lord, in your mercy, hear my prayer. Father God, I also pray for the world, for each nation and their leaders, for Great Britain, our Prime Minister, the government, and our representatives at national and local levels, for Singapore and all places around the world. Help us to turn to you in faith, seek understanding of this virus, and make the right decisions during this challenging and ever-changing time. I pray with thanksgiving for your compassion and ask your favor to guard our hearts, minds, and bodies. Lord, in your mercy, hear my prayer. And Almighty God, I pray for the Church. Help our spiritual leaders and everyone who is in your body on earth to be the light of Christ in every place, in all that we say and think and do. May every task that we undertake not be perfunctory, but be filled with your truth, that we may hope, and the light of our hope would be evident to all around us. Almighty and everlasting God, increase in us your gift of faith, that forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to that which is before. We may run the way of your commandments and win the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We have come to the end of morning prayer. Thank you for joining me. I hope you would consider a pattern of dedicated time with God each day, each week, be it at the start of each day, during the day, or at the end. And so we close morning prayer together. The Lord bless us and preserve us from all evil and keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.